dopo. Di Dalai Lama, on September 4, 1997, said, in human societies, there will always be differences of views and interests. But the reality today is that we are all interdependent and have to exist on this small planet. Therefore, the only sensible and intelligent way of resolving differences and clashes of interests, whether between individuals or nations, is through dialogue. The promotion of a culture of dialogue and non-violence for the future of mankind is thus an important task of the international community. What is a culture of dialogue? A culture of dialogue is one in which people habitually gather together to explore their lives, their differences, their dreams. Each facet of such a culture would contribute to people learning together, building healthy relationships with each other and the natural world, and co-creating better prospects for their shared future. A useful definition of this dialogue in this culture of dialogue is shared exploration towards greater understanding, connection, and accessibility. By definition, dialogue must be two-way or multi-directional communication where those involved are not trying to limit or each other's understanding, connection, or options. So to build a culture of dialogue, we need to, one, dialogue as far as we can, and there is always farther we can go, but we all reach our limits. Two, help all stakeholders believe that we have shared exploration and benefit are possible. And three, fight where necessary and as co-intelligently as we can to bring power holders into peer dialogue. A good example of this is Gandhi of India. There are some opportunities that he could have beaten the British. He could have won over the British, but he did not take those opportunities because he wanted to dialogue with them as peers. The third and last perspective I like to present is the interreligious dialogue. And for this perspective, I rely on the Jesuit priest, Father Thomas Michel. He said, people sometimes think of dialogue as situations in which religious leaders and scholars sitting down together, making pleasant, optimistic statements, choosing their words guardedly, trying to put a positive twist on controverted questions, and carefully avoiding any topic that might cause friction or hurt feelings. In short, they are thinking of something akin to an interreligious tea party. If this were what dialogue was really about, it would be hard to understand why the Catholic Church, beginning the Second Vatican Council and developed over the past 25 years in the consistent teaching of Pope John Paul II, has been so insistent in urging Christians to be committed to interreligious dialogue. For example, we can hear the very powerful statement of the Pope in his 1991 encyclical Redemptoris Mission, paragraph 56 and 57, about interreligious encounter. And I quote, "Each member of the people and all Christian communities are called to practice dialogue, although not always to the same degree or in the same way. For most," the Pope continues, "this will be through what is called the dialogue of life." This is a strong statement. Does the Pope really mean that each member of the people and all Christian communities, including all Catholic religious institutes, should in some way be involved in the practice of dialogue? Obviously, the Pope is not speaking of tea parties. The Pope is proposing that dialogue with the followers of other religions should be a characteristic of the mission in the world that Jesus has entrusted to the community of his disciples. Just as our army of Christ should include daily prayer and worship of God, a special concern for the poor and victims of oppression and injustice, care for the sick and the aged, so also one of the basic elements of our Christian mission is the encounter with people of other faiths. These are all aspects of the one mission which Christ has given us. One might say that dialogue is the other side of the obligation to proclaim our faith in this world. There are millions of people in our world who are seeking God, who are looking for a way to live with God's will, who want to find meaning, a reason for living in their daily situations. We have a duty to share with them the Christian faith that has given direction to our lives, that inspires us and gives us the courage to love, that sustains us and gives us reason for hope in moments of failure and aspiration. But there are many other millions of people who are good, honest, and self-sacrificing, who are not searching for God. Precisely because they have already found and daily encountered the divine in and through the religion they already found. To the practice of their own religion, be it Islam, Judaism, Buddhism, Taoism, or the traditional religion of various continents, God's Spirit is guiding them, enabling them to pray and worship, and inspiring them to reach the heights of self-sacrifice, generosity, and service of others, and enabling many to plant the depths of spirituality and mystical experience. They love their religion. It means as much to them as our own Christian faith means to us. The Church teaches us that we have much to communicate and much to learn. This whole world of positive relations with the followers of other religions is summed up in the word dialogue. Although in 1979, in his first encyclical Redemptoris Hominis, is already in 1979, in his first encyclical Redemptoris Hominis, Pope John had this to say. What we have just said must also be applied to activity for coming closer with the representatives of the non-Christian religions. An activity expressed in dialogue, contacts, prayer in common, investigation of the treasures of human spirituality, in which, as we know well, the members of these religions are not lacking. Does it not sometimes happen that the firm belief of the followers of the non-Christian religions, a belief that is also an effect of the Spirit of Truth operating outside the visible confines of the mystical body, can make Christians ashamed at being open themselves, so disposed to doubt concerning the truths revealed by God and proclaimed by the Church, and so prone to relax moral principles and open the way to ethical permissiveness. It is a proper thing to have a predisposition for understanding every person, analyzing every system, and recognizing what is right. This does not at all mean losing certitude about one's own faith or weakening the principles of morality. Redemptor Hominis number 6. My brothers, this is a strong paragraph, packed with advice in creating a culture of dialogue with the Church, with the other religions. He notes that the benefits of dialogue are not only for the other ones, but also for us Christians. Can't the firm belief of the followers of other religions open with us a shame of our doubts and laxity? He stresses that the belief of others is an effect of the spirit of truth. He underlines the inability of the commitment to dialogue or being open to understand others, analyze their belief systems, and recognize all that is good in them. That this principle involves losing confidence in the beauty and truth of all Christian faith. If this eighth summer Catechetical Institute sharpens our awareness of the importance of dialogue among cultures, pushes us to exert effort to build a culture of dialogue, and deepens our desire for interreligious dialogue, for me, we have achieved our objective and our expenses in the Messiah. From here, we can continue to ever deepening our awareness of dialogue in many aspects, even among dioceses. Thank you.
Thank you, Bishop Francis. Your Excellencies, Bishop Francis and Archbishop Ramon, beloved confreres.